Hello. Your Royal Highness, Excellencies, dear guests, friends and colleagues. My name is Eva Sophie Arnstell and I'm the director of this museum, the Army Museum. And I wish you all very welcome here today. As you understand, it's a great honor for us to host this event and this exhibition, and I must thank the ambassador for asking us to host the exhibition, as this is part of a peacekeeping operation that was in Cyprus, started 50 years ago, and we have this exhibition behind me about peacekeeping operation that Sweden were part of. And this exhibition as a whole has been here for 4 years, and this is the very end. So it's the final countdown now that we celebrate with this exhibition. And our mission here at the Army Museum is to try to explain and discuss the impact of the armed forces in Swedish society. And we do that not only by exhibitions about what has happened in Sweden, but also what happens abroad now and, of course, yesterday. So again, many thanks to the ambassador also for the nice reception and the food. And I also very, very shortly wish to thank Olle Westerberg and Sven Pettersson from the Army Museum, who mounted the exhibition here and also transferred this hall into a very nice area for today's event. So, very welcome. Thank you for coming here. And the floor is yours, Mr. Ambassador.
Thank you, Ms. Arnstell, and allow me to express my sincere gratitude and appreciation to you for hosting the photo exhibition 50 Years UNFISIP in Appreciation. I cannot think of a more fitting venue. I wish to also thank the staff of the Army Museum for their hard work, and I would say imaginative solutions to ensure its success with very little lead time. Your Royal Highness, State Secretary, members of the Riksdag, Excellencies, Your Eminence, Metropolitan Kleopas, Swedish government officials, President of the Swedish Veterans Federation, UNFISIP veterans, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. I'm delighted to be able to welcome so many of you to today's opening, and I'm truly honored by the presence of His Royal Highness Prince Carl Philip, Patron of the Veterans. Allow me to also thank the Swedish government offices, the armed forces, the police, the Folk Bernadotte Academy, and the Swedish Veterans for their Federation of Swedish Veterans Federation for their kind support. This photo exhibition, marking 50 years since the establishment of the United Nations Peacekeeping Force in Cyprus, or UNFISIP, as it is known to all, has toured other countries, and I felt it only appropriate to also bring it to Stockholm. In doing so, we express our thanks and appreciation to Sweden, and recognize the important contribution of the 28,000 Swedish peacekeepers who served in Cyprus from 1964 to 1993, representing Sweden's largest and longest engagement in a UN peacekeeping operation. Sadly, during this period, 17 Swedes died in Cyprus. In remembrance of those Swedish peacekeepers, a wreath-laying ceremony took place at the Veterans Monument in Djurgården earlier this afternoon. On March 4th, 1964, the United Nations Security Council adopted Resolution 186, establishing a peacekeeping force in Cyprus. It was tasked to use its best efforts to prevent a recurrence of fighting and, as necessary, to contribute to the maintenance and restoration of law and order and a return to normal conditions. By the end of March, UNFISIP was operational, and amongst the first peacekeepers who arrived there were those from Sweden. They arrived at a difficult time with the outbreak of intercommunal trouble and the real threat of a Turkish invasion. Allow me to recall the words of Colonel Carl Gustav Ståhl, commander of the Swedish battalion, who, in his leaving speech during the winter of 1964-1965, remarked, "I am convinced that without the United Nations intervention in Cyprus, the situation would be a lot worse, more tragic, not only in Cyprus, but for the whole world." That tragedy unfolded in the summer of 1974 with the Turkish invasion and occupation, which continues to this day. UNFISIP was immediately thrust into having to broker local ceasefires and to assist the affected population. Its urgent role became one of assisting the UN High Commissioner for Refugees, the International Committee of the Red Cross, and other international relief efforts. UNFISIP offered assistance to the victims, brought medical and food supplies, worked towards locating missing persons, and the release of prisoners of war. The force assumed the monitoring of the 180-kilometer buffer zone running across the island. It was also given an expanded humanitarian mandate of providing emergency assistance and thereafter humanitarian relief to the displaced. Even today, UNFISIP continues offering assistance to the remaining but dwindling numbers of Greek Cypriots and Maronite Cypriots in the occupied area. In recent years, UNFISIP has also played an important role in the demining of the buffer zone and facilitating the opening of crossing points between the government-controlled area and the occupied areas. And since 2003, there have been over 20 million incident-free crossings, firmly debunking, I believe, the myth that the two communities cannot work and live together. For the Swedish peacekeepers, 1974 was particularly difficult, as their sector included the Famagusta district and the coastal town of Famagusta, located in the east of the island. This vibrant city fell to the advancing Turkish forces and today is often referred to as the ghost city of Famagusta, a phrase coined by the Swedish journalist Jan Olof Bengtsson. I'm certain that this resonates with all veterans who served in Cyprus and who remember Camp Carl Gustav. Your Royal Highness, distinguished guests, Cyprus has been forcibly divided for too long. During the 40 years since 1974, what has remained constant is the commitment of the government of the Republic of Cyprus to achieve a just and functional solution that reunites the island and the Cypriot people. A reunited Cyprus free from occupation troops and where human rights and fundamental freedoms are enjoyed by all Cypriots. As the President of the Republic of Cyprus, Mr. Anastasiadis, stated at the opening of this same exhibition in Nicosia earlier this year, "I look forward," he said, "to the day in the not too distant future when an exhibition commemorating UNFISIP will be inaugurated in a peaceful, reunited Cyprus, in a reunified country where Greek and Turkish Cypriots will reap the benefits of a shared and prosperous future, just as their forefathers had done in the past. In a reunited and blossoming Cyprus, which former peacekeepers will visit to form new memories of peace." Shortly, His Royal Highness will do us the great honor of opening the exhibit. What you will see is a time capsule showing the chronological evolution of UNFISIP, its role and its activities. In this photographic journey, what is evident is the continued relevance, need, and importance of UNFISIP. This evolution has seen many changes, including participation by more and more female peacekeepers. In fact, UNFISIP was the first peacekeeping operation that female Swedish peacekeepers participated in, and I'm pleased to recognize the presence of some of these veterans today. UNFISIP is also the first UN peacekeeping operation headed by a female force commander, Major General Christine Lund, a Norwegian. This recent appointment raises to 33 the number of troop-contributing countries to UNFISIP since 1964. Many are represented here by their ambassadors, and I take this opportunity to also express Cyprus's appreciation to them too. When viewing the exhibit, in one of the panels on the backside over there, you will come across a 1964 black and white newspaper article showing the engagement of a tall 22-year-old Swedish sergeant who had recently arrived on the island to a beautiful young Cypriot woman. That same year, 50 years ago, another Swedish-Cypriot combination tied the knot. Both couples have made their home in Sweden, and I'm very pleased that they were able to join us today. Let me end by addressing the veterans, and through you, to the 28,000 Swedes who served in Cyprus wearing the blue beret. Though the exhibition itself may be small in size, it comes with a big thank you from the grateful people of Cyprus. Your Royal Highness, I express again my gratitude to you for honoring us with your presence here today, and to all of you for your participation. Thank you. It now gives me great pleasure to ask to come to the podium State Secretary at the Ministry of Defense, Mr. Jan Sallerstrand, an UNFISIP veteran himself. State Secretary.
Your Royal Highness, Mr. Ambassador, Your Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen. It is a privilege to stand before you today and commemorate the 50th anniversary of the United Nations peacekeeping force in Cyprus. It is seldom that we think of the astonishing fact that Sweden alone has contributed with 28,000 soldiers and police personnel during the years of 1964 to 1993. This constitutes, as the ambassador mentioned, Sweden's largest contribution to a UN peacekeeping mission, and I am proud to say that I have been one amongst them. I also think it is too seldom that we recognize the incredible job the United Nations peacekeepers do. However, just like beauty, the value of the United Nations lies in the eye of the beholder. Case in point, in today's media frenzy, we only tend to hear about the challenges the United Nations is facing, and we forget the larger picture. Let me make my perception clear. Today, UN has more than 97,000 uniformed personnel, military and police, coming from over 110 countries. In addition to this, the United Nations agencies are able to feed hungry, house the displaced, save lives in an unparalleled scale around the world. The World Food Program will feed 80 million people this year alone. And UNICEF provides children with fresh drinking water, immunization, equal access for girls and boys to education. And the United Nations is at the forefront of the Ebola-affected countries today. Turning back to the United Nations peacekeeping force in Cyprus, we have seen peacekeepers throughout the decades achieve success in monitoring the ceasefire. The peacekeepers in Cyprus have come from nations large and small. All have brought different cultures and experiences to the job, and all have them been united in their determination to foster peace. Today, we have also, as the ambassador mentioned, a force commander, Major General Lund, who has made a special mark for the UN and of her own, of course, by being the first female force commander in the history of the United Nations. Great efforts have gone into patrolling the buffer zone and in keeping the peace. This has been done thanks to UN peacekeepers that have bridged the differences by building confidence and fostering understanding. Many of you here today will have labored such high-risk efforts. All veterans should feel a great sense of pride and deep satisfaction of such contribution that you have made. I also like to give my sincere thanks to Mr. Ambassador for organizing this anniversary and allowing us to highlight the gratitude to our veterans. Thank you very much, and I will now hand over to a veteran himself, Per. Please.
Thank you. Your Royal Highness,
Excellencies, honored guests, ladies, gentlemen, and AMFISIP friends. I am one of the 28,000 who served in Cyprus as a Swedish peacekeeper. In my time, I was there from April 74 to April 75, a very interesting time and a very dangerous time. It's an honor for me to be here today and to talk on behalf of all Swedish veterans, men, women, soldiers, police, who served between 1964 and 1993 in Cyprus. Our contingent that arrived in the spring of 74 was the smallest Swedish UN contingent ever that came to Cyprus. We arrived to an island that was rapidly becoming a booming, growing, popular holiday destination. It was a Mediterranean paradise. However, things rapidly changed and it became a zone of war and unrest. On the 15th of July, there was a coup by the National Guard and the Greek junta against the President Makarios, who fled the island. After that was a short civil war. A week later, the Turkish forces invaded Cyprus in the area of Kyrenia, from where they later moved out in the second phase and occupied a little over a third of the island. And the troops are still here in Cyprus. Because of the events in the summer, AMFISIP was strengthened, and so was the Swedish battalion. In early August, we received 450 additional soldiers and policemen to our little contingent of Swedes, and we're now a fully fledged battalion. In the middle of August, on the 15th of August, we saw the Turkish forces, mechanized, moving across the fields from Kyrenia into Famagusta and the old city. And they stopped at the outskirts of Famagusta in Deridia. Like most people who've served in a UN mission, I have many memories, some positive, some pleasant, some not. I want to share with you one of my experiences. On the 20th of April in 1975, just before I was supposed to go back home to Sweden, the first ever Women Walk Home March took place. A total of 20,000 women with banners were marching towards Deridia. And initially the plan was that they would cross over the Turkish checkpoint and retake, in inverted commas, the occupied, deserted town of Famagusta to claim its right to the rightful owners. In the end, there was an agreement that they would stop short and instead hand over a document to the UN demanding the immediate return of Famagusta. I have never in my life seen so many women and banners in one day. I can promise that. Fortunately, the whole event ended without any major disasters, and we could all return, the women their way, and we back to our camp in Camp Victoria, Camp Carl Gustav, where we had a late dinner. My tour in Cyprus ended a week later, by the end of April, and I returned to Sweden, where I soon realized, and so did everyone else who came back, that everyone asked, how was it? What happened? And when we started to talk about events, they turned a blind eye and crossed their ears and said, oh, we don't really want to know. It's too far away. It doesn't happen to us. we're safe in our country, which was a bit disturbing. We had experienced something they had not, and they couldn't imagine what it was. I decided to go back to Cyprus again, but this time not in uniform, but dressed as a civilian. And I went back to marry a young, beautiful lady, Alexandra, who I met in the autumn of 74. I came to Larnaca. We got married a month later, twice to be sure, once a civilian, and secondly in an Orthodox church. We are still married, and next year we are celebrating our 40th wedding anniversary on the 6th of June. We spent many years living in Sweden, in England, and Denmark, but finally we decided we will go back to Cyprus, and we moved there in the beginning of 1988. And that is a move I've definitely never, ever regretted, and neither has my wife. With regards to developments in Cyprus, we know what happened. We've heard it. Amphisip is still around, 50 years after it was set up as a temporary 3 months mission. It's still here or there. We also know what has not happened. 40 years after the Turkish invasion of Cyprus, an occupation of a third of the country, there is still no solution to the Cyprus issue. This must happen. Finally, on behalf of all Amphisip veterans, present and not present, men, women, I would like to thank the organizers for bringing this exhibition to Sweden. In May of this year, 125 veterans from 1974 spent a week in Cyprus on a 40-year reunion. We had this reunion 1 week too late to see the exhibition. It was already closed. So now we're grateful, Mr. Ambassador, that you brought this exhibition to Sweden so we can come here and see it. We also wish to thank Armé Museum for bringing this show, showing us the pictures. And finally, I want to thank the Swedish government, the Swedish Armed Forces, the Swedish Police, the Folke Bernadotte Foundation Academy, and the Swedish Veterans Federation, all of whom are supporting this exhibition. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Hedlund. Your comment about marrying a Cypriot, I think, together with the two other couples, is a perfect advert for the bilateral relations between Cyprus and Sweden. So we thank you for that. And now, ladies and gentlemen, it gives me great pleasure and an honor to welcome to the podium His Royal Highness Prince Carl Philip, Patron of the Veterans.
Ladies and gentlemen, I had the opportunity just before before we open this expedition to walk around and see the expedition, and I must say it's a very nice expedition, and it's very nice, also interesting to see all the photos and the information that you will soon see. Before I open the expedition, I will also take the opportunity to thank all the veterans, all the 28,000 men and women that have been down there under these years. In the bottom of my heart, I will thank you so much for what you have done and the service, and also to remember those friends, if you call them, the men and women that are not with us. Earlier today we were giving the flowers at the UN monument, and I think it's very important that we recognize the men and the women who are down there in the UN, under the UN flag. So with those words, I would like to declare the expedition open.
Where are you?